When you were holding daily press conferences, the people of Western and southwestern Sydney were continually asked to comply with the rules, and yet case numbers continue to climb. So what hasn't worked or isn't working there?
I think that's the wrong assumption to make in terms of the case numbers. Had we not imposed the strict lockdown conditions as well as the vaccination rate, we would have seen thousands and thousands of cases just in that part of Sydney alone, and worse, thousands and thousands of hospitalisations and death. And that's what we have avoided. But we also hear heart-wrenching stories every day of families who are losing loved ones, of people who are suffering this horrible disease. And our job is not done until we vaccinate as much of the population as possible. And what is really, really encouraging is some of those communities most affected by COVID in Western and Southwestern Sydney had a very low vaccination rate at the beginning of the outbreak, down to as low as 19 or 20%. Those same communities are now late 80s or even 90% vaccination rate for first doses, and that's just an outstanding result. And I can't thank everybody enough for really responding, sticking to the rules as hard as it's been, but also coming forward and getting vaccinated.
So if they're sticking to the rules and you're saying they're complying out there, a lot of them still feel like they're being unfairly treated. Is that a fair call?
Oh, I think every citizen is entitled to feel that way. As citizens, all of us, no matter where we live or what our circumstances, have had our freedoms curtailed quite substantially. And this is to protect us, protect our loved ones and protect the greater community. But I think all of us have a right to feel, not so much me, I'm the one that ultimately has to make the decisions based on the advice we get, but I think every citizen has the right to feel frustrated and resentful because of the way all of our freedoms have curtailed. And I can tell you as a decision maker, it's a horrible feeling to have to impose decisions or have to impose conditions which take basic freedoms away. But the upside is it's a temporary measure. And now that we have the vaccination rates where we are and the fact that we're going quite well on that front, we can look forward to freedom, seeing loved ones, in October, and we're anticipating it'll be around the middle of October when we have those double dose vaccination targets. And I think all of us will feel relief, especially those that are doing it really tough in Western and Southwestern Sydney.
Can you understand why they might feel like they're being unfairly targeted, though, when Health Minister Brad Hazzard, as early as last month, said that there are other communities and people from other backgrounds who don't seem to think that it's necessary to comply with the law and who don't really give great consideration to what they do in terms of its impact on the rest of the community? He seems to be suggesting that people who look less like him and more like me are more likely to break the rules.
Oh, look, I wouldn't read that into Minister Hazzard's comments at all. He's a very compassionate, understanding person, and all of us have had to deal with a very difficult situation. And, you know, as someone who comes from a very proud migrant family with a very extended family, which we regard as one family, I can imagine the stresses that have been placed on households. And I can imagine the stress it's put on those family links. I mean, these are situations which none of us expected, but we've had to act according to what the virus is doing. And the reality is, unfortunately, all those fantastic workers we rely on to get food on the table, to work in our healthcare system, to work in other essential areas, in the main, come from Western and Southwestern Sydney. And that's unfortunately meant that the case numbers have been increasing because over time, because obviously workplaces and households, the science tells us, are the two places where the virus has been spreading the most in Sydney, in New South Wales. And the challenges have been really severe. But also, can I say, I'm incredibly proud of our communities for coming forward. And many communities have put aside long-held beliefs and concerns about vaccination, long-held beliefs and concerns about what we're all going through. And I'm so proud of those, our communities, I should say, because we are in this together. But the balance that a government has to strike is how can you, in the best way, protect the community and not put any extra burden on any part of our community unless you absolutely have to. And that's how we've responded. We've let the science and the data really base our decision making.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about that point you've just made there, that you know that home gatherings were a big part of the outbreak, especially in Western and Southwestern Sydney, but being able to visit other homes in Sydney will be allowed as part of this reopening plan. So how do you plan on policing numbers, knowing whether people are vaccinated or not, when we know that people visiting homes is a problem in terms of spreading this virus?
Well, no, nobody's allowed to visit anybody's home until we get to that 70% double dose.
So that's a part of this reopening plan, though, isn't it?
Oh, it's 70%, but we're not there yet. That's at least, you know, some weeks away. Albeit we're closer to that point than we were from when we started the lockdown. So I think all of us can look at that period of time with optimism in terms of when we get to that date in October. But
that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about reopening. So as part of the reopening plan, people will be able to visit other homes. So how are you going to police who's vaccinated and who's not?
Well, from the first day of the pandemic, the first day that we realised we had a global phenomena here in New South Wales and Australia, we have relied on a couple of things. Firstly, good systems which allow us to keep track of people doing the right thing. But secondly, and more importantly, personal responsibility. Even now, when you have rules and laws in place, you can't assume that every single citizen is doing the right thing every second of the day. But you can assume that the vast majority of people are knowingly and willingly obeying the law and the rules that are in place. And that is no different in a pandemic. In fact, it's heightened. And I think in a pandemic, none of us can say we haven't been touched by what's going on. All of us know somebody who may have had the disease or worse, succumbed to the disease. And I think all of us realise what a serious situation it is. And those that we hurt the most if we do the wrong thing are those closest to us. I mean, I hear every day heartbreaking stories of the guilt people feel in passing on the disease to those closest to them. And even if they're going to be okay, their loved ones may not be. And so we do rely on personal responsibility and people's good faith. And I have eternal trust in the people of New South Wales that not only will they knowingly try their hardest and make sure they stay within the rules, but also respect that our actions don't only impact those closest to us, but the broader community as well.
Well, speaking of the broader community, again, as part of the reopening planned, travels to regional areas will be permitted. But tell me, what happens if someone vaccinated or otherwise brings the virus to an already vulnerable regional community?
Well, this is why it's really important for us to have those high rates of vaccination across the state. So New South Wales not only is working hard and inching towards that 70% double vaccination figure, but on average, we have 80% of our adult population, 16 and over that is, with already one dose. And that is great. So that means when we do start opening up, those that are vaccinated can participate in activities which unvaccinated people can't. But that level of adult vaccination coverage gives us assurance that the vast majority of our vulnerable communities are protected. And that's why we're urging now, we're saying be prepared for when society opens up. Make sure everybody you know in your life has been vaccinated, and especially our older members of the community. I mean, over the age of 70, we have about 90% vaccination coverage, which is very good.
But vaccinated people can still spread the virus,
is still a lot of people.
Right?
Exactly, which is why you still have rules in place, which is why you have to succumb to living with COVID. And you have to make sure that even when you open up, you have good QR systems in place, mask wearing in certain settings, good social distancing, and that you're also careful around very vulnerable people. I mean, my parents in their 80s, and I will always be careful around them. Because as much as I want to be with them, we have to assume that vulnerable communities, vulnerable individuals still can get the virus even if they're vaccinated and still suffer illness. But obviously the chances are vastly reduced. If you're vaccinated, you're less likely to get the disease, you're less likely to spread the disease, and you're less likely to end up in hospital. They're the facts. And we eventually have to come to a position where we're living with COVID. We can't stay cocooned and locked up forever. And we have to make sure that we keep the community as safe as possible by them, which is why in New South Wales, we've been madly requesting everybody to come forward and get vaccinated, making sure that we make the vaccines accessible in communities where the rates have been low. We've gone out to the community rather than expecting the community to come to us. And even in rural and regional remote communities, we've made sure that if there's particular regions or townships who are lagging the rest of the state, that we have a proactive way in which we can offer them vaccines. So the real key initiative is by the time we open up at 70% double dose, we know that we'll have at least 80% of the adult population with a first dose because we're already there. We'll have a substantial number of 12 to 15 year olds that are also vaccinated, and all of that gives us extra comfort in addition to making sure that you still have some level of restriction in place. It means life's much better and much freer than what it is now, but it also means that when you're going into a venue, you have to respect the COVID safety plan. You have to be prepared to do things which allow us to live safely in a COVID world.
Premier, obviously a lot of debate between the states and territories about reopening borders. Now, this is your chance to speak nationally. So what's your message to the premiers, chief ministers and people of other states and territories?
Well, I think the key message for all of us is we need to work together as Australians, because we can't stop families within our own country from reuniting. We can't stop Australians from coming home. These are the realities. We have to have a compassionate approach, and we also have to accept that whether we like it or not, we need to live with the virus, and we need to prepare ourselves for that. And the national plan has a deadline, gives us a benchmark for what is a safe way to reopen. And we know that New South Wales is likely to get to 80% double dose ahead of other states, but we don't expect other states to open their borders to us until they have those vaccination rates according to the national plan. But I urge all states, once they reach those targets, to stick to the plan. It's good for our nation, it's good for our citizens, and it's good for those Aussies who are waiting to come home and be reunited. I get messages every day from people who haven't seen loved ones for a long time. And we want to change that. We want to make sure we create a safe way that we can live with the virus, but also live as we should, and that's with the ones we love the most.
Premier, thanks so much for joining us on SBS World News.